Steps to Life 2016 Camp Meeting and this Gospel of the Kingdom shall be preached to all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Matthew 24:14. May you all be blessed at this year's Camp Meeting 2016.
The message that I prepared to study with you this evening is about prophecy. But it has directly to do with church organization. Before we get started in the Bible reading about prophecy, I want to have a word of prayer and ask the Lord to help us in the few minutes we have together, that we will learn what he's trying to teach us. Father in heaven, as we are now going to open your holy book and attempt to read it and understand it, we earnestly pray that your Spirit will direct and control and influence our minds, that the angels of heaven may influence our thoughts, that we may receive divine assistance in our attempt to understand what you want us to know. Give us a heart to obey and follow you, we pray. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. God is a God of order. You believe that? Ellen White wrote one time that order is heaven's first law. That was written in a periodical. It's copied. That statement is copied in the book Counsels on Health, page 101. And what is order? Well, order is, first of all, that everything, a thing is something that takes up space, everything has a specified place. And if you're in order, everything is in its place. Order has another component. It has to do not only with space, but it has to do with time. So if I am orderly, then there's a time for everything. Does the Bible say that there's a time for everything?
Yes.
It says that in Ecclesiastes 3. And so if I'm orderly, not only is there a time for everything, but I am on time. This was not natural for me to learn. It was not natural for me to learn as a child to try to pick up my clothes, to keep my room tidy. I was not naturally an orderly person. It's been something that I have to pray about and say, Lord, help me to become this way. Because Jesus was an orderly person, and if I'm going to become like him, if I'm going to go and dwell with him, the Lord is not going to take me up to heaven to clutter it up. So I must learn to be orderly. When Jesus came forth from the tomb, he was the majesty of heaven. He could have asked any one of innumerable angels. They would have been happy to do it for him. But he did not ask anyone to do it for him. Before he walked out of the tomb, he folded up his grave clothes. I studied that. I said, Lord, forgive me. Help me to become like that. But Jesus was not only orderly in regard to his person, his clothes. He was orderly in regard to time. And being orderly in regard to time has to do with being on time. And the one commandment of all of the Ten Commandments that I have learned the most about that is the fourth commandment. In order to keep the fourth commandment, you need to have some sense of logistics. Have you ever started getting ready for the Sabbath too late? Have you ever had that? Have you ever done that? And then you say, "Oh Lord, I wanted to be ready." I struggled with that for years. I finally figured out, I think I've told some of you this before, I finally figured out I was never going to be on time for the Sabbath. I would either be late or early, and I decided it would be better to be early. Because I'm not going to be on time. I tried that too many times. See, with human regulations, when I was in college, I had that figured out. I had a watch with a sweep second hand, and I used to time things. I didn't like to waste time. And I knew the exact number of seconds that it took me to either walk or run from my dormitory room to the classroom in the second or third floor of the administration building. I knew the exact time so that I could walk into class just as the bell was ringing. I used to do that all the time. I didn't want to waste any time, didn't want other people wasting my time. I would walk into class just as the bell was ringing. I had it timed. But I found I couldn't do that with the Sabbath. Because when I tried to be ready just on time, somehow, I personally believe that the devil was involved in it. Somehow, things would go wrong. And I wouldn't be just on time, so the only way I could be on time was to be early. Now, God is a God of order, and order involves time. And so we find this in the Bible over and over again. And what I want to talk to you about this evening is about the appointed time. The appointed time. There are many appointed times written about in the Bible. In fact, did you know that the devil has an appointed time? The devil has an appointed time. You want to read it in your Bible? Look in Revelation, the 12th chapter. Revelation, the 12th chapter. Verse 12, rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you having great wrath, because he knows that he has what? A short time. The devil knows that God has placed a time boundary on him, and his time is going to run out. Ellen White wrote about that. Let me just read you an interesting statement where she wrote about that. This is in the book Upward Look, page 39. Today, Satan has great power in the world. He has been permitted to have proprietorship of this earth for an appointed time. Did you know that? He is the proprietor of this world, but it's only for a temporary time. And there's an appointed time when his proprietorship is going to come to an end. During this period, when iniquity prevails, men and women are given a chance to take sides. In every possible way, Satan tries to make the broad road attractive and the narrow road grievous, humiliating, and objectionable. He lays ingenious plans to allure men and women to indulge appetite. Cheap, unsatisfying pleasures are made all and in all in this degenerate age. Satan throws his glamour about these amusements, which eclipse eternal things. Many will sell their birthright, as did Esau, for a trifling consideration by the indulgence of appetite. Isn't that awful? Can you imagine selling your eternal inheritance for food? Can you imagine that? She says many will do that. Esau did it. Worldly pleasure will appear more desirable to them than the heavenly birthright. What a tragedy. The devil's trying to get you to sell your birthright. He knows that his time is about up. His appointed time is about over. As I mentioned, the Bible talks about many appointed times. In the days of Noah, God appointed to the world how much time? 120 years. You have 120 years to repent. That's in Genesis 6. There is an appointed time for many different things in the Old Testament. For instance, circumcision was to be done on the eighth day. And even if the eighth day after the baby was born fell on Sabbath, it would still be done on Sabbath. And Jesus talks about that in the Gospel of John. He told the Jews, he says, even on the Sabbath day, you'll circumcise a man so that the law of Moses won't be broken. So that was an appointed time. There was an appointed time for the birth of John the Baptist. Zechariah and his wife had been praying for I don't know how many years. They wanted a child. And it looked like they were never going to have a child because now it was too late. They were both old. But God heard every one of their prayers. And when they started praying, Ellen White says that God had appointed a time when they were going to have a child. It was a lot later than they thought. But God appointed a time. And at the appointed time, they had a child. The Bible talks about an appointed time for the judgment on Nebuchadnezzar. The Bible talks about an appointed time for a judgment on Jezebel. The Bible talks about an appointed time to make David king. In fact, so that I get this done before we completely run out of time tonight, why don't we look in the book of Daniel, and I'll just show you a few appointed times right in the prophecies. We're going to study prophecy. By the way, we're living in a time when there is great theological controversy. And so nobody can preach about anything about in theology or prophecy or anything without somebody saying, oh, that's not right, it's this way. And by the way, if you don't agree with something, some interpretation that I or somebody else preaches on prophecy here, if you don't have time to talk to us about it here, why don't you write us a letter and explain to us the way you would explain it. By the way, don't bother to send me books. I already have stacks of books on how all kinds of people have interpreted prophecy. I was at a camp meeting a few months ago, and this lady came up to me, and she wanted to talk to me about prophecy. I was talking to her a few minutes. She says, I want you to understand this. So she gave me some books, and I got these. And as I was preparing for tonight, I thought, oh, I better look at one of these books that goes on into these prophecies. So I looked it over, and I prayed about it. I always pray when I look over these things because actually, if somebody has new light, I want to know what it is. But I don't want to be misled either. So I pray and say, Lord, is there something here this person says that I need to learn? Must be thousands of pages of letters, people trying to teach me things. And so I read it over, prayed about it, and I said, Lord, if there's new light here, I don't understand it yet. I want to be taught, but I don't see it yet. I have to see it from your word. I have to see it from inspired writings. I have to know. You see, if there's real, let me tell you something. If the Lord really has new light for us, the new light will not contradict the old light. Well, our time is going very rapidly, and I'm trying to be orderly, too, on time. So let's get into the book of Daniel. Let's look at a few things about time and the appointed time. That's what I want to study with you about in prophecy, is about the appointed time. So look in Daniel 8. Look in Daniel 8, verse 19. Here's what it says. And he said, look, I am making known to you what shall happen in the latter time of the indignation. For at the appointed time, the end shall be. When's the end going to be? At an appointed time. And when is the appointed time? When is the appointed time that the end is going to be of Daniel 8, 19? Come on, you're Seventh-day Adventist. When is it? What? When you accept the message? Is that when the end is? Is that when the appointed time is, end is here? Thank you. I got like one person that know it. Good. 1844. That's when the appointed time was. Spoken of Daniel 8:19. Now, Adventists believe that for almost 150 years when I was a teacher at Southwestern Adventist College, and the very first year that my wife and I were at Southwestern Adventist College, I was a teacher there, she was later a teacher there too, we had a bombshell that hit the Adventist church by a teacher from Pacific Union College that had come here from Australia. And people came to me and they said, you know what? What we thought was so really isn't so. Or what is it? Well, if you knew what the Hebrew text said, you would. I thought, what? What are you talking about? What we believe as Adventists isn't so because there's something in the Hebrew text that's translated wrong. There's some. I said, we're going to find out about this. Now, I'm not a Hebrew scholar, but I have studied both Hebrew and Greek at Andrews University. I studied Greek at Walla Walla College for 3 years, and I studied both Greek and Hebrew at Andrews University. And I said, we're going to find out. Well, we're going to find this out. And so I decided it's time to renew. I was teaching health science, but I decided it was time to renew my study of Greek and Hebrew, and I started studying Greek and Hebrew. And I especially decided in Hebrew, I would read in Genesis. That's the easy place to read in Hebrew, to get brush up on Hebrew. But then what I really wanted to read was the book of Daniel. So I took the book of Daniel. It's in Aramaic and Hebrew both. And I started going over it and over it and over it, word by word by word, checking it, double. What's wrong with the Adventist message in the Hebrew language in the book of Daniel? I couldn't find anything wrong with it. In fact, the more I studied, I said, what the Adventist pioneers believed is confirmed by the Hebrew language. It's not destroyed by it. It's confirmed by it. And but as I studied, I did realize that the book of Daniel is not always correctly translated, and the reason it's not always correctly translated is because the translators, and I'm not trying to criticize the translators, but they did not understand the meaning of what they were translated. Have you ever tried to translate something into another language, but you didn't know the meaning of what you're trying to translate? That's difficult to translate. And so they were trying to make sense of it, and sometimes they did make some mistakes. I did find that. But the mistakes that were there, actually, when you go back to the Hebrew, those mistakes that were made in the translation, that doesn't destroy our message. If you go back to the original text, our message gets stronger, not weaker. Amen. The translation mistakes just make the message harder to understand instead of easier to understand if you go to the original language. And so when I went to Daniel 8, by the way, Daniel 8, if you start at Daniel 8, Daniel 8, 1 starts in Hebrew. I'm very thankful for that because I'm much more comfortable in Hebrew than Aramaic. The early part of Daniel is mostly in Aramaic. But in Daniel 8, it starts in Hebrew. And this appointed time in Daniel 8, 19, we believe was fulfilled in 1844. Now, but that's not the only appointed time in the book of Daniel. There's appointed time in Daniel the 9th chapter. Look in Daniel the 9th chapter, starting verse 24. It says here, 70 weeks are determined. The Hebrew word is chafak, and that word would literally be translated cut off, and that's actually a better translation. A literal translation would make more sense and be better here. It would be better to translate it, 70 weeks are cut off for your people. By the way, what's it cut off from? The 2300 days. And if you look at the context, Daniel 8 and 9, you need to study them together. 70 weeks are cut off. Actually, when I started studying this in the Hebrew language, in order of it word by word over and over again, Daniel 9:24, when you get into it, it'll just bring goose flesh to you. It'll just electrify you what happened here. Notice there were six prophecies that were made that were going to be happened during this 490-year period. And it says, during this time, it says, this is for your people and for your holy city. This is for God's professed people, the Jewish people, to finish the transgression, or I prefer the translation, to finish the rebellion, to end the rebellion. You have 490 years more to end your rebellion. They were in captivity because of their rebellion. You have 490 years to bring that to an end. But during this time, there's also going to be an end made of sin. That is an electrifying statement to me. During this 490-year, and that actually happened, during this 490-year period, something happened to make an end of sin, a permanent, forever end of sin. And it said also to make reconciliation for iniquity. Was reconciliation for iniquity made during this 490-year period? Yes, it was. And then it says to bring in everlasting righteousness. Was everlasting righteousness brought in during this 490-year period? Yes, it was. And then it says to seal up the vision and prophecy. Once this 490-year period has come to an end and this prophecy has been fulfilled, all the Bible, every prophecy in the Bible is confirmed because of what happened during this 490-year period. And also, number six, during this 490-year period, the Holy of Holies is going to be anointed. Now that's a subject, you could preach many sermons just on that. That right there, just that last one. This is an exciting time period, an exciting appointed time in the book of Daniel. And it also says in this prophecy, before you come to an end of it, that there's going to be an abomination that's going to desolate, that's coming after the end of this period. Well, you get done with that and you go into Daniel 10, and notice it talks about an appointed time right away again. Look in Daniel 10:1. It says, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar. The message was true, but the appointed time was long. The appointed time was long. What appointed time? To understand this, you need to understand that Daniel 10 and Daniel 11 and Daniel 12 are all one vision. There are three chapters, but it's all one vision. Daniel 10, Daniel 11, Daniel 12 are all one vision. You need to study those together. And so when it says the appointed time, it's talking about the appointed time in this vision of Daniel 10, 11, 12. Let's see what this is all about, because there's actually several appointed times in this vision. Go over to Daniel 11. Let's read Daniel 11:24. See if we can brush up a little bit on prophecy. Daniel 11:24. He shall enter peaceably even into the richest places of the province, and he shall do what his fathers have not done, nor his forefathers. He shall disperse among them the plunder, spoil, and riches, and he shall devise his plots or plans against the strongholds, even for a time. Now, a time is a year. Same in Hebrew and Aramaic, same word. For a time is for a year, so that's how long? That's a prophetic time, so it's in how many years? 360 years. That happened, by the way, exactly according to prophecy. When did those 360 years begin? When he began to devise his plots, his plans against stronghold for a time? It began at the beginning of the pagan Roman Empire. When was the first year of the pagan Roman Empire? It was in 31 BC. And if you add 360 years of that, you come to the end of that time. That's 330 AD. It's an exact 360 year period. And the Roman Empire, the emperors of the Roman Empire did exactly what the prophecy said they would do during that 360 year period. And at the end of that period, the capital wasn't in Rome anymore. It was moved at the end of that period, 330, it was moved to Constantinople. Well, but that's just the beginning. Now look what it says in verse 27. It says, both these kings' hearts shall be bent on evil, and they shall speak lies at the same table, but it shall not prosper, for the end will still be at the appointed time. These two kings
are going to be speaking lies, and they're both going to have their own agenda. They're going to be against one another. They'll each have their own agenda, but what they're going to try to do isn't going to happen. It's not going to work because God's in control of things, and the end is not going to come until the appointed time. When's the appointed time? Everybody's silent. No, it's not 1844. That was Daniel 8. Oh, my, I better tell you, you're quiet. The appointed time is 330 A.D. Isn't that what we just read in verse 24? He's going to do this for a time. These two kings, what they're going to try to do is not going to work because the end is going to be at the appointed time, which is 330 A.D. But now, go down to verse 29. Now, this is where you have a translation mistake in most of our English Bibles. It would be better to translate it, the first part of verse 29, as follows. Toward the appointed time. At is not the correct translation. Toward the appointed time. Not at the appointed time. Toward the appointed time. In other words, as you are approaching 330 A.D. What's going to happen as you are approaching 330 A.D.? Well, it says, toward the appointed time, he shall return and go toward the south, that's Egypt, but it shall not be like the former or the latter. It won't be like the former time when Julius Caesar did it. Now, that's described in Daniel 11. Neither will it be like the latter time when Octavian or Augustus Caesar did it. It won't be like either one of those. It'll be totally different. That happened exactly as prophesied. Recently, I've been reading different books, Milman, History of Christianity, Philip Schaff, History of the Christian Church. It's amazing. All these church historians, they document this exactly. They did hundreds of pages in the church history books about this. What happened, what eventually happened out of all this, is you can read it down there in verses 30 and 31. What eventually happened is the Roman power took away the daily, or as it's mentioned in Daniel 8:12, the daily in rebellion. It removed the daily. The word tamid means continual, continuous, always, daily, something that's just always around. From a human point of view, it's been there forever. Not really, but this power is going to remove the daily in rebellion. It's going to remove the continuance in rebellion, and it's going to set up something worse than that. It's called the abomination of desolation. And I have a history book here written by an Adventist by the name of B.G. Wilkinson that I could take time to document that for you. Take three pages of reading. We don't have time. We don't have time to read it through. You'll have to read it for yourself. But how long is that going to go on? Well, notice what it says. If you read down through the verses, then in verses 32, 33, 34, 35, notice what it says is going to happen. It says in verse 33, this is after the abomination of desolation is set up. It says, those of the people who understand shall instruct many, yet for many days they shall fall by sword and flame, by captivity and plundering. Now the word many, by the way, is a word that is added by the translators. It's not in the original Hebrew text. However, that idea is implied in the Hebrew text. We won't go to that now. They're going to fall by a flame. Were people burned to the stake when the abomination of desolation was set up? We don't even know how many thousands. Were people destroyed by captivity? Were they put in dungeons? Yep. All this happened. How long is this going to go on? If you were Daniel and you were listening to this and you were having a vision and you were seeing this, wouldn't it come into your mind, well, how long is this going to go on? Wouldn't you have that question? I would. So the angel told him, how long is it going to go on? Look at what he said. Look at verse 35. It says, and some of those of understanding shall fall to refine them, purge them, and make them white until the time of the end, because it is still for the appointed time. Notice there again, It's for an appointed time. This great tribulation, as Jesus called it, when the abomination of desolation has been set up, is going to go how long? It's going to go clear to the time of the end. Well, now, how long is that? When is the time of the end? Now, in Daniel 11 and 12, that's one of the main focal points, one of the main subjects, is when is the time of the end? Now, you can get a clue as to when the time of the end comes if you read, first of all, from Daniel 7. Now, notice, God's people are going to suffer this terrible tribulation, this terrible persecution, until the time of the end. So it's implied that at the time of the end, some way this is going to stop. Jesus said that the days would be shortened, or otherwise no flesh would be saved. It would be that bad. How long is this going to be? Turn back to Daniel 7, and you'll see the same thing forecasted. Daniel 7, starting in verse 25. It says here, he, that's the little horn, shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and laws. The King James Bible says he'll wear out the saints of the Most High. It's a terrible persecution against God's people. How long is this going to go on? It says, then the saints shall be given into his hand for a time, times and half a time. How long is that? That's 3.5 years. That's 1,260 years. When did this period of time, the appointed time, when did that begin? Well, if you look back to verse 8, if you look back to verse 8, when you compare that with verse 20, you can see when the career, if I can say it that way, of this little horn power would begin. Now, this power existed clear back in the days of the apostles, because the apostle Paul says that the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. So it existed back in the times of the apostles, but it could not be called a little horn power then. Because look in Daniel 7, a horn represents a king or a kingdom. This power, as the apostle Paul makes very clear in 2 Thessalonians 2, this power could not exist as a kingdom as long as the Roman Caesar was in control of the world. The Roman Caesar would not allow a competitive power to rule over him. But Paul said the power that's restraining is going to be taken out of the way. And when that happens, then the man of sin, the lawless one, is going to be revealed. And Daniel 7 reveals that in the process of this little horn coming into existence as a little horn. Now remember, in its spiritual sense, it existed clear back in the days of the apostles. It was developing for hundreds of years, but it did not become a little horn power until it had independent kingly authority, because that's what a horn is. It's a king or a kingdom. That's what Daniel 7 says. A horn represents a kingdom. And when we study in a church history book, we find out that Rome was divided up into 10 kingdoms, like it says in Daniel 7, between 351 and 476, over 125-year period. But there were three of those powers that were opposed to the Bishop of Rome having independent kingly authority. In fact, Odoacer, the king of the Heruli, he would not allow them to select any pope without his permission. But you know what? The Eastern Roman Empire was contacted, and they sent armies in there, and they were able to destroy the kingdom of the Heruli. In the 490s, they were only in existence about less than 20 years. They got destroyed. That's one. There was another power. They were wreaking havoc all over the Roman Empire, especially with their navy. And that's where we get the word vandalism today. They were called the Vandals. They also were what we call today, the church historians call them, Arian Christians. There was a huge controversy between what is called Arianism and Trinitarianism that went on for hundreds of years. It started as you approach the appointed time. That's when it started. And it went on for hundreds of years. It wasn't like what happened to Julius Caesar or Augustus Caesar. It went on for hundreds of years. And so the Eastern Roman Empire was contacted again. They sent a general down there, and they finally were able to destroy the Vandals in 534. And the second one is out of the way. The prophecy says three of them are going to be uprooted in the process of this power coming on stage. And so the third one to be uprooted was the kingdom of the Ostrogoths that controlled Italy. And they were uprooted by the armies of Belisarius, and they withdrew from Rome for the first time. The battles actually weren't totally over yet, but they withdrew from Rome for the first time in 538. So 538 is the earliest date that can be assigned for the little horn power being an independent kingdom. Before that, they were never independent. But starting in 538, they were independent. And they were a union of church and state. And it was that union of church and state. By the way, if you think it through, just think it through in your mind. If you have a union of church and state, and so the church tells the state, this is the way we want people to live, and the state then enforces the laws of the church, and then if you break a law of the church, that becomes a civil crime, and you become a criminal, and then you go to prison if you don't do what the church says, tells you to do. That's what happens when church and state gets united. That's not just what happened in Italy, that's what happened in England with the Protestant churches. I'm sure you're all aware that during the Protestant Reformation, this is one of the sorriest, saddest aspects of the history of Protestantism, that Protestants are also guilty of martyring some other Protestants that didn't believe like they did. So they had union of church and state. And that, by the way, was one of the greatest stimuli, they say, for people to flee from Europe, and that's how people came to America at the first, just to get away from this church and state to a place where you could be free to worship God the way you believe you should worship God. So, when then does the time of the end begin? This great tribulation was going to last, it says in Daniel 11:35, till the time of the end. The time of the end would be 1260 years after 538. There's two ways actually to compute it. In 533 was when Justinian made the decree. And in 1793, 1260 years later, was when that was abolished by the legislature in France. But it's not enough to just set something up by decree or abolish it by decree. It has to be an actual fact. And when it was done, an actual fact was in 538 and 1798. On January 1, 1798, Napoleon said to his general Berthier, I want you to go down to Rome, and I want you to take the Pope prisoner. And he went down there, and by the middle of February, the Pope was taken prisoner, and he was taken to France, and he died in house arrest in Valence, France, in 1799. This 1260-year period is so important that it is mentioned seven times in Bible prophecy. It's mentioned in both Daniel and Revelation. Look what it says about it in Daniel 12, verse 7. It says, then I heard the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river when he held up his right hand and his left hand to heaven and swore by him who lives forever that it shall be for a time, times and half a time. And when the power of the holy people has been completely shattered, all these things shall be finished. There you have it again. It's mentioned in Daniel 7:25. It's mentioned in Daniel 12:7. It's mentioned without the listing of how many days it is. In the 11th chapter of Daniel, just says it'll be many days, and it'll last till the time of the end. So, now here I am, having a hard time with time again. That, on my notes, that was the introduction to my sermon. I'm going to show you a few things in prophecy in Daniel, And I have 12 pages of notes here about the appointed time. And so I have to abbreviate things very quickly, all right? So I'm not going to have time to read very many references. But that what I showed you in Daniel is just an example that from God's point of view, everything has been apportioned out. There's an appointed time for everything. We don't know what many of the times are. Paul said to the Athenians, he says, their times have been pre-appointed. You can read that in Acts 17, about verse 26. I mentioned Noah. I mentioned some of the things in the Old Testament. There were promises made to Abraham. I would love to read you the references on that, but we're going to have to leave that out. Abraham, there was a twofold fulfillment to the promise of Abraham. His descendants were promised the land of Canaan from the river, the Euphrates, clear down to the Arabian Gulf. They were promised that whole territory, and they got that whole territory in the days of David and Solomon. But that was just the temporal fulfillment of the promise to Abraham. The promise to Abraham, actually, the Apostle Paul says it was a promise that he was going to be an heir to the whole world. And if you're Christ, then you're Abraham's seed, he says, and you're heirs according to the promise, and you are going to inherit the world. You're going to have a piece of Abraham's farm. By the way, are you going to have a piece of Abraham's farm? If you're saved, you will. I'm sorry, I just got too long-winded, and I don't have time to read you the interesting Ellen White statements where she talks about this in detail, the fulfillment of the promises to Abraham. She talks about it in the book Patriarchs and Prophets and several other places. At the first advent, we already went over in Daniel 9, there were several things that were appointed. For instance, there was an appointed time, an exact time, for the birth of Christ to occur. There was an appointed and exact period of time for Jesus to work in the carpenter shop. There was an appointed and exact time for the baptism of Jesus. There was an appointed and exact period of time for his ministry. There was an appointed exact time when he would die on the cross. There was an appointed and exact time for the resurrection. There was an appointed and exact time when the Holy Spirit would be poured out. None of those things happened by chance. Thousands of years before it happened, it was appointed an exact time. When God called Abraham, do you know when God called Abraham? God called Abraham on the very day of the year that Christ was crucified. And 430 years later, the Bible says in Exodus 12, the children of Israel went out of Egypt on the self-same day. God said, you're going to be there this many years, and on the self-same day they went out. And that self-same day was the same day that Jesus was crucified, the same day of the year that Jesus was crucified. See, God knew all about that. God knew what day, year Jesus was going to be crucified, clear back when he called Abraham. Everything from the divine point of view, it's been all apportioned out. My friend, your life and my life, we have been appointed. We don't know the amount of time that God has appointed in this world, but we've each been appointed some time. God has already decided. If we're going to be saved, we have to be saved during the appointed time. And that's why the Bible says, now is the appointed time. Now is the acceptable time. Now is the time of day of salvation. Don't postpone being saved. Wonderful. I think I have 4 minutes. I want to just review with you very quickly in the next 4 minutes the appointed times in regard to the second advent. Now, I reviewed with you just a moment ago several appointed times at the first advent. Does the Lord have appointed times at the second advent too, just like at the first advent? Well, of course he does. We already went over Daniel 8:19. There was an exact appointed time when the investigative judgment would begin. That was decided thousands of years ago. Exactly when that would be. Exactly when that would start. so that I don't run over time, I'm just going to show you a whole bunch of them real quick. I have the references for all of them right here in front of me, but we don't have time to read them. I'm just going to show you a whole bunch of appointed times. I want you to understand that from God's point of view, everything has been appointed. There's a time appointed for everything, including your life. That how much time left do you have to be saved? God hasn't told you. He's told you that now is the appointed time. If you hear the gospel, you need to give your heart to the Lord now. Don't wait, because you don't know how long you have. I must start telling you stories about that. Not that I couldn't. Let me read to you several appointed times so you see that God has an appointed time for everything. Here they are. Here's a whole bunch of them. God not only has an appointed time for the investigative judgment, God appointed a certain amount of time, an appointed time for the three angels' messages to go to all the world. I can read you that. God has appointed a time for the purification of the church. I can read you that. God has appointed a certain time for the loud cry to be given. I can read you that. God has appointed a certain time for the end of the gospel and the close of probation. That time has already been decided. God has appointed a certain time when His wrath, His destructive judgments are going to fall on this world. That time has been appointed. God has appointed a time, it was appointed thousands of years ago, when He is going to bring out the Ten Commandments that He wrote on tables of stone and gave to Moses. He's going to bring those out and show them to the whole world. I can read you that. He's appointed a time. He's going to do that. And God has appointed a time for the deliverance of His saints. There's an appointed time when God's children are going to be delivered from all the machinations of the enemy, not have to worry about anything the devil does anymore. And finally, I was interested, this is opposite what I was taught my whole life, but I can show you the references, I have it right in front of me. There is an appointed time for the second coming of Christ, and it was decided thousands of years ago. Let me tell you, friends, when time runs out, we studied it last night, there's going to be a lot of people, they're going to say, the harvest is past, summer's ended, we're not saved. And the thing that's so sad about that is they all could have been saved. And my dear friend, every one of you can be saved. But please, please don't presume on the mercy of God. Don't assume that because you've received mercy all your life that the mercy is going to go on forever, because it's not. And that's why the Bible says, Jesus told His disciples, He says, you don't know when the time is. That's why Paul said, if you hear Him speaking to you today, don't delay, don't harden your heart. The way you harden your heart is by saying, I'll do it later. People very seldom say, no, I don't want to be saved. They don't say it that way. What they say is, I'll do it later. I'll do it tomorrow. You don't know whether you have tomorrow. I'm more than out of time. But let's pray about this. Is this serious that we should pray about it? Let's pray about it. I want to pray for you. You pray for yourself while I pray for you. Father in heaven, you know how much time each one of us has been appointed. We don't know, but you know all about it. And Lord, I pray for anyone here who is hearing the voice of your Holy Spirit, and maybe that man or woman or young person has heard your voice speaking to them hundreds or even thousands of times before, and they've kept postponing it, making a full surrender to Jesus Christ. And we're so stupid that some way we think that we can do it tomorrow, and that better opportune, more opportune, easier time never comes. Help us to realize that if we're going to be saved, that when the Holy Spirit speaks to us, we need to respond, because we don't know whether the Holy Spirit's going to speak to us again or not. Help us to realize that the appointed time is going to run out, the time to be saved is going to run out, and that if we're not saved, we'll be lost. Oh, Lord, I pray for each person here. Lord, if there's anyone here and your Holy Spirit is speaking to that person and saying, it's time to make a full commitment, a complete commitment to Jesus Christ, Lord, help us to realize that He cannot accept us unless we make a complete commitment to Him, that it takes all to buy the field. Oh, Lord, help each of us to make that commitment and to be serious so that we will not come up to the end and find out that we procrastinated too long. I pray this in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.
Thank you for joining us at this year's Camp Meeting 2016. You may contact us by mail at P.O. Box 782828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You also can reach us by calling 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. And our email address is historic@stepstolife.org. Or you can visit us on our webpage at www.stepstolife.org. Thank you, and may God bless you.